Good morning, everyone. I'd like to welcome you all today to our online worship for High Street Presbyterian Church for Sunday the 28th of June. We pray that God will bless our worship and our virtual fellowship today. I would like to take the opportunity today to thank all who are involved in the production of all of these different aspects of our online worship. And particularly today, I'd like to thank the very Reverend Dr. Ivan Patterson, as Ivan will be bringing to us God's word later on in our time of fellowship together. Now, I'm sure that many of you have been following all of the developments in relation to the easing of the lockdown restrictions. And last week, there was an announcement that worship services will be able to recommence from Monday the 29th of June. Now, I want you to bear in mind that our services are recorded on a Thursday, so I'm talking to you on a Thursday morning. Tomorrow there is going to be a Zoom meeting of the Temple Patrick Presbytery. On Monday we'll be having a meeting of our Kirk Session in High Street. And all of these meetings are going to need to take into account any government announcements, especially those that will be taking place later on today from the Northern Ireland Executive. So all of that really means that we will not be recommencing our services next Sunday. God willing, that will be happening very soon, and that's what we all want. We want it to happen as soon as possible. But for us as a congregation, as for all congregations, there is a lot of work that we need to do to prepare our building. And not only our building, but also ourselves for the changes that need to be made. Things will not be the same as before for the immediate future. The format of services is very likely to be different. Social interaction will have to be limited. Seating is going to be different because of social distancing. It is unlikely that we will be singing, and services will also be shorter, although that aspect of it might be quite popular. It is very likely that we'll be following the format of a prayer, a reading, and a talk. Now, we hope to have music in our service, but not singing. So God willing, next week, I will have much more detail for you. I'll be able to report back after the meetings that have taken place with Presbytery and also with our Kirk Session. But for all of us as a congregation, I'm sure that the most important thing for us is that everyone is safe, and looking after each other is absolutely fundamental for us. Things will have to be different when we return, but we will get through this. We will get through this with God's help and also with God's blessing on us as a congregation of His people. Let us all come together now to worship Him. Let us all pray together. Helper of the helpless. So much of our lives lie shattered and tattered. Our minds wander through the wreckage of the last few brutal months. Our hearts are heavy through the havoc wrought by suffering. The deficit of distance is felt in even our closest relationships. Just making ends meet seems to matter more than it has for a long time. And our souls are shredded by the strain and stress of uncertainty. Oh, restore us, we plea. Restore our souls, Lord, our shepherd. Restore us, Lord God Almighty. Make your face shine on us, that we may be saved. Restore our fortunes, Lord, like streams in the Negev. Restore our withered hands, sightless eyes, troubled minds, by today's touch of the Master on the broken body of the church he loves. Restore to us the joy of your salvation, and grant a willing spirit to sustain us. Let us rejoice like Jacob and be glad like Israel when you restore us as your people. God of all grace, who called us to your eternal glory in Christ, after we had suffered this little while. Restore us and make us strong, firm, and steadfast, as we ask these things in the name of our Saviour Jesus. Amen. Our reading today is taken from Luke's Gospel, from Luke chapter 4, reading from verses 13 to 22. Let us all now hear God's word. When the devil had finished all this tempting, he left him until an opportune time. Jesus returned to Galilee in the power of the Spirit, and news about him spread through the whole countryside. He was teaching in their synagogues, and everyone praised him. He went to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, and on the Sabbath day he went into the synagogue, as was his custom. He stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was handed to him. Unrolling it, he found the place where it is written, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favour." Then he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. The eyes of everyone in the synagogue were fastened on him. He began by saying to them, "Today this scripture is fulfilled in your hearing." All spoke well of him and were amazed at the gracious words that came from his lips. "Isn't this Joseph's son?" they asked. Amen, and may God bless to each and every one of us this reading from his word. Let us again all pray together. Father, we thank you for your word today. We thank you, Lord God, for that blessing that it is to each and every one of us. Now, Lord, we pray that you might be with your servant Ivan as he proclaims your word to us, that he will know your liberty and grace and strength. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. I'm now going to hand over Ivan. Ivan will preach God's word and close our time together.
Good morning, everyone. I'm sure you perhaps agree with me that it's good that the restrictions that we have lived with these past weeks are beginning to ease, so that we can have some freedom after the lockdown. And maybe like me, you're beginning to feel more hopeful as one restriction after another is being reduced, and that soon we'll be able to enjoy a bit more freedom. It's been a difficult time, feeling so restricted and isolated. In Luke 4, that was read for us, Jesus has just returned to Nazareth after his self-isolation in the desert, where he was tempted by the devil. On the Sabbath, he goes to the synagogue, and he's invited to read the Bible. And he reads from Isaiah 61. "The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." And after he reads it, he amazes the people when he says, "Today this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." These words came as a surprise to his hearers, that somehow in Jesus they could find freedom and hope of enjoying the Lord's favor. Some of the people who were in the synagogue were asking, "Who does he think he is?" Throughout his ministry, Jesus had an uncanny ability of taking people by surprise, whether it was through the people he befriended or the attitudes that he adopted. His values confounded many. Do you remember how he praised the widow's mite? The Authorized Version says, against the ostentation show of others who gave so much more. Showing that it's generosity of heart that makes for greatness. He said as well that to think hatefully was akin to murder. Again, it's what's in the heart that makes for greatness. And when he said to forgive 70 times 7, that was a test of character and of showing a good heart. Harboring resentment was a sign of heartlessness. And so we find him in the synagogue. It was a custom of any good Jew to be at worship on the Sabbath. In Jesus' day, they didn't have paid or appointed ministers or preachers or teachers. And so on a Sabbath, any adult male might be called upon to preach or teach. And so Jesus was handed a scroll from the book of Isaiah and asked to preach on it. Isaiah 61 was a passage of great importance to the Hebrew people. These words spoke of a new era of blessing for the people, a blessing they had been waiting for generations. And then when Jesus was sure that he had everyone's attention, he closes the scroll, he sits down, and he shocked them as he announced very simply, you will find good news. You will find release and liberty. You will know God's favor as you respond to me, because I have come from God the Father to bring in a new era. He was announcing that he was the fulfillment of all of God's promises and purposes. He was that special person. He was coming to lift up the hurting, free the oppressed, give sight to the blind, and bring about what they had been longing for some 700 years. They had waited for the fulfillment of this prophecy, and now a poor, no-named carpenter claims to be the one who would proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. Their longing for God's new era of blessing, of hope, for a beleaguered people had come in him. Now perhaps these past weeks of lockdown gives a glimpse of how the Jewish people felt, as today we wait on our government to speak of freedom and to give us hope in the face of the pandemic of COVID-19. And some people have been telling me that they have stopped listening to the news, as it is all doom and gloom. Very little to encourage us, much to dishearten us, making us ask, will life ever return to normal? And it's hard to know the answer to that question. And yet the promises in Luke 4 is something to hold on to if our faith is rooted in God through faith in Jesus Christ. Listen again to the message that he brings as he applies Isaiah's words to himself. He brings good news that God loved them. He brought release to those who felt captive, both socially and spiritually. He brought a new understanding. They would recover their sight to see the truth. A sense of liberty would be proclaimed, and that new era would be a blessing for all. I want to focus on two words which might just encourage us as we wait to see if life is ever going to get back to any kind of normal. The words are freedom, that sense of liberty, and hope, a new era ahead, hopefully of blessing for us. So firstly, freedom. We know a little of the importance of freedom as our physical lives have been restricted. We haven't had a great deal of liberty, although thankfully things are changing week by week as the government assesses the state of the virus. The whole picture of slavery, of being held down, that lack of freedom has come to our attention again after the death of George Floyd in America. We look back to people who spoke against such things and had real backbone, like Wilberforce, to bring it to an end. And it must have taken courage for Jesus to say that day in the synagogue that he was the answer to the longing of the Hebrew people, longing for a new day, that he had come to sort things out for them. Also, when Jesus spoke of freedom, the people were amazed at the grace he was showing towards the people they wanted to see destroyed. He was saying, let's not destroy them. Let's show grace and attempt to make them friends. Of course, that scandalized many of the people who are out for vengeance. And yet he was saying that God is a God of freedom. And his desire is to open up our lives to experience the Spirit of God at work in us. Freedom of being sure that God has not left us alone, even in this pandemic crisis. And more, that he brings about a fundamental freedom that ought to affect our hearts. The Bible speaks of that as a freedom from sin, as the good news takes us to the cross, and there we find forgiveness. And through faith in Jesus Christ, who came to seek and to save the lost, in him we proclaim, or can proclaim, that nothing in all creation can ever separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus, our Lord. So Paul reminds us of his contentment in Christ as he says, I have learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. I can do all things through him who gives me strength. God is with us. Christ has come to demonstrate that, to set us free, to give us, the next word I want to use is hope. Hope of knowing that God is still working his purposes out in the world today. Paul tells us that the whole creation is groaning, waiting to be set free from pollution and viruses and sin, evil, death. And wherever Jesus went, he brought hope to all sorts of people. He brought hope to the leper, exiled from his home and his community. He really gave him back his life again. He gave him back a status as a human being who could take up his place in society again. He brought hope to people who felt worthless or lost or broken or rejected. Jesus brought the message that God loved them, that they had a purpose in life. Even in Jesus' last moments, when he was dying in agony on the cross, remember how he offered hope of eternal salvation to the thief dying beside him? And when you think back to the beginning, Jesus' first act of being born in Bethlehem tells us that he came as the Savior, the one who was going to change things for us. And his last act before death was that giving of hope to that criminal. Hope for now and hope forever. He was reminding his hearers that there is a freedom that only God can give, and that is every bit as necessary as having no more restrictions on our lives. Earlier on in Luke 4, Jesus is confronted by the devil, and Matthew records it this way: man shall not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the very mouth of God. I think most of us are hoping to hear that COVID has been conquered, and that may well take some time. We need to continue to pray that our government will be guided to make the right decisions. We need to pray that we will soon be able to be back together in church. But the hope that God gives us in Christ is much more comprehensive than being able to be out and about and shop again. The good news he gives has both temporal and eternal significance. God cares about our general well-being, every bit as much as he does for the captives, the poor, or the blind. And these words convey that which is expressed so clearly in John's gospel, that God loved the whole world, that he gave his only son, that whoever believes does not perish. However, he also announced that riches on earth are meaningless. It's treasure in heaven for which we should be striving. And he showed that a healthy body is worthless if one's soul is dead in sin. And so here is why Jesus came, and why he was sent from the loving heart of the Father to bring freedom, to set it free, those things that hold us down, to give us hope, and to bring us into a whole new era of blessing, because there is good news of God's love to us in and through his Son. And so may the Spirit of the Lord be upon you. May the good news assure you that in him you are pardoned from your sin. May your recovery of sight give you a vision of hope for the future. And amid all the oppression that is around, may you know his love, giving you a spirit of liberty and hope for today and for tomorrow. Now let's join together in prayer. Lord God, we pray for your blessing at this time, that we will be refreshed by the good news of the gospel of Jesus, that through faith in him, we may know your freedom, freedom from sin, freedom to live well, to give us new hearts, for you came to seek and to save the lost and to give us hope as we look to the future. So in Christ's name, as we come to offer you our love and take hope for today and tomorrow, we unite to pray together as Christ taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. And now may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all, this day and always. Amen.